Good afternoon. I'm very, very grateful to Vrinda Pathare and Pallavi Ramane, the Godrej Archives, for inviting me here to speak to you on the occasion of Engineers Day 2018, and for the very, very generous introduction. Yesterday, I had the chance to see the exemplary archives on this campus. And I also know that at Godrej, you've had the pleasure of listening to many illustrious scholars and artists as part of your annual lecture series, the Culture Lab Initiative, and other forums. So it's a real honor for me to be invited to address you on this significant day for engineers. I must thank you also for the really striking publicity posters, which says, Mera Beta Engineer Banega. It reminded me of the song, Papa Kehte Hain, from Kayamat Se Kayamat Tak. And it's a college farewell party, and Aamir Khan's character is singing, Koi engineer ka kaam karega, and pointing out to this studious looking guy wearing glasses. A minute later, he's pointing at a long haired, confident student and singing, Koi business mein apna kaam kare, naam karega. You see, in Indian movies, really good students must do engineering. Through this, they may build the nation and stand for the forces of rationality and integrity, as Dharmender's character did in the 1969 movie Satyakam. But crucially, they must secure their careers and their families' well-being. This is not a phenomenon restricted to Hindi movies. The part of the country that I come from, the popular Tamil movie Kandukondain, Kandukondain from the year 2000, Ajit Kumar plays a young man called Manohar. Manohar's dream is to become a filmmaker. We first meet him on the set of a movie where he's serving his apprenticeship as a lowly assistant, attending on the leading lady as a song is filmed. Suddenly, a chauffeur-driven car arrives on the scene, screeching arrogantly to a halt. Manohar's father steps out of the car, as you can see, smiling in a disdainful, sardonic way, and he says, "Is this what I sent you to America for? Could you not have been sensible and studied engineering? Instead, here you are making a movie. If you had looked after our factory, you would have had 500 or 600 people working under you." Now, this scene is, for the purposes of my talk, a masterpiece of condensation, three or four lines of dialogue that neatly underline the themes that I want to address. The safari suit wearing father, a businessman, wishes his son would take over his factory. But not merely as proprietor, mind you. Instead, he must gain a professional qualification. Needless to say, that qualification should be that of an engineer. It is a respectable thing to be, a far cry from being an assistant on a movie set. What is more, he would be in a position of power, with 500 or 600 people working under him. And it's with some such hope that Manohar was sent to America. Instead, he has returned with some inexplicable artsy-fartsy ideas about making movies. The eminent historian Ramachandra Guha was once quoted as saying that two of the things that keep India together are cricket and Bollywood. We might add a third, engineer worship. According to official estimates, there were 3,346 institutions in the country offering undergraduate degree programs in engineering and technology as of March 2012. Together, they had about 15 lakh seats, with more than 2 lakh graduates entering the market each year. The sheer magnitude of these numbers may still be surprising to some, but the general trend that they suggest doesn't shock anybody anymore. Where once the Maharaja and the snake charmer were stereotypes of the country, it is now engineers, computer engineers, that the world thinks of when it thinks of India. The Indian character Ashok in the popular Dilbert series, who's an IIT graduate, illustrates this perfectly. Bangalore and many other cities today have become world famous in a way that they weren't before. Bangalore was once a little pleasant little town known as the Garden City or the Pensioner's Paradise, but it's today a bustling metropolis heaving under the strain of its own uncontrollable growth. An almost endless supply of engineering graduates is required to keep this engine and others like it oiled and running. A generation of children is growing up with one particular career in mind. William Dalrymple's book, Nine Lives, contains the story of a sculptor in the temple town of Swamimalai near Kumbakonam, whose family has been carving bronze statues for 35 generations. The sculptor's son wants to be a computer engineer. But the cult of the engineer in India is much older than the recent post-liberalization phenomenon involving IT, software, and outsourcing. Even a generation or two ago, engineering was firmly established as one of the most desirable career options. In my high school, we were about 70 students in the science stream, and I believe nearly all of us went on to enroll in an engineering degree program. Certainly, most were aiming to get into an IIT. In that bastion of middle-class ambition, it didn't occur to us that we could do anything else. What then is the secret behind India's love affair with engineering? Are there sociocultural factors that make the Indian particularly suited to engineering, or that make engineering particularly desirable to Indians? We could come up with many hypotheses. To begin with, it's a professional qualification. And a professional qualification, as any lawyer or doctor will tell you, is a safety net in career terms. In the Indian context, the absence of an effective social security system, the historical experience of poverty, and the need to support large families made careers a matter of financial stability rather than job satisfaction. Engineering, close to the world of production and consumption and wrapped in the cloak of objectivity and analytical rigor, becomes, in such an environment, a worthwhile calling. You can't discuss philosophy, nor indeed history or literature, on an empty stomach. Furthermore, a career as an engineer is a tool of social mobility. You just have to look at how the lives of some IIT graduates, for instance, change within one generation, and at the most two generations. But very often, it's within one generation that their circumstances are drastically altered. It's also been speculated that this affinity to engineering comes from a culture which, since ancient times, has prized mathematical skill. And certainly, generations who have been fed bhindi by their grandmothers, supposedly to improve their maths, and chided by their grandfathers for having been careless when they scored 99%, will vouch for this. Engineering, it is also said, acquired a great deal of prestige from its association with nation building in the immediate aftermath of independence. India's first prime minister was a great believer in what he called a scientific temper, and many Indians view the Nehruvian regime as the moving force behind the modernization and industrialization of India, from the building of mammoth dams and steel plants to the setting up of institutions like the IITs. But all these are impressions, speculations, hypotheses. How can we understand engineering in India in a more systematic way? I'd argue that any worthwhile inquiry must begin with an excursion into history. Of course, I'm a historian. In the remainder of this talk, I will draw on my research to give a broad historical outline of engineering in modern India. And I'll focus on the period before independence for two reasons. One is that, as you can see from the title of the book, that's the period that I've actually researched myself and I'm best placed to speak about. And the other reason is that the post-IIT phase will be well known to many of you in the audience. In fact, some of you would have lived through that experience, and I cannot presume to talk more authoritatively than you, although I'd be glad to discuss it in questions if it comes up. Now, the word engineer itself comes from the French term ingénieur, which refers to a constructor of military engines. Military engines, or engines of war, were the cannons and other machines used in warfare in 14th century Europe. It's therefore not surprising that the earliest group of people in India to identify themselves by the English term engineer was the East India Company's corps of military engineers in the 17th and 18th centuries. These men were tasked with building roads, bridges, and fortifications required by the army. In the mid-19th century, as colonial rule began to consolidate itself, a separate civilian department called the Public Works Department, or PWD, was established. And this, incidentally, is the origin of the term civil engineering. They were called civil engineers because these were engineers who were not part of the military, as all previous engineers had been. And I remember getting a great kick out of finding out this piece of information about 10 years ago. The PWD, the fast-growing railways, and the military accounted for most of the engineers working in India at this time. And nearly all of them were imported from Britain. You can see here a building site of a railway bridge in the 19th century. These engineers were initially sent out to India to staff the PWD, and they were trained by the traditional British method, that is, by apprenticeship to a practicing engineer. There was no tradition of going to college and getting a degree until late in the 19th century. In 1870, though, a special college was set up at Cooper's Hill near London to train engineers for the Indian PWD. And in fact, this is one of the earliest British colleges to offer an engineering degree program. And in the years after that, several other colleges started to offer such programs. Well into the 20th century, top-ranking engineers in the Indian government came from Britain as a rule. In 1922, for instance, alumni of this college in Cooper's Hill accounted for 62% of officers in the rank of chief engineer and 52% of superintending engineers. There were, of course, Indians too, trained at the engineering colleges of Roorkee, Shibpur near Calcutta, Guindy, Madras, and Pune, all dating from the 19th century. But these Indians were mostly employed as subordinates, draftsmen, overseers. Some of them were recruited as officers, but they formed a cadre that had lower status, lower salaries, and lower benefits than the engineers imported from Britain, although they did similar kinds of work. Now, engaged as they were in building the roads, buildings, and irrigation works of Victorian-era India, engineers were seen as important representatives of the imperial power, and therefore their training was planned accordingly. As a prominent British journal declared in the year 1870, the ideal engineer for India is a man who will take £1,000 a year as his average income for life, and so on and so forth. And you can see here the kinds of ideas being expressed about what one must be to be an engineer. In other words, an engineer was supposed to be two things. First, he must be a noble, incorruptible gentleman. And second, he must be a generalist, able to take on a very wide range of tasks. A typical government engineer's duties were managerial as much as technical. He had to oversee accounts, order materials, manage contractors, examine designs, and conduct inspections. As you can see from this very partial list of files on the desk of one particular engineer in the 1930s. So let's return for a moment to the college at Cooper's Hill, which I mentioned. Imagine a group of officers emerging year after year from one college outside London and fanning out across the various Indian provinces. In other words, this college had a deep influence on the culture of the PWD. And Cooper's Hill engineers were trained to be gentlemen. Even the entrance exam included English history, classical languages, apart from maths and science subjects. In the college, students worked hard, but they also had an Oxford-Cambridge kind of lifestyle with billiards, wine, formal meals in hall, and so on. Colonel George Cheney, the first president of the college, said that PWD engineers should be, I quote, not only good engineers, but religious men, at any rate Christians in feeling and profession, end quote. In later years, Cooper's Hill College was closed, and graduates of other British engineering colleges were chosen for the Indian PWD by a selection board. Here too, gentlemanliness was emphasized. And this is illustrated by a wonderful interview of Geoffrey Hall, a graduate of the Central Technical College in London. And he leaves an account of this interview in his typescript memoirs. He was interviewed at the India office in about 1910, the India office being the arm of the British government, which takes care of Indian affairs. And in his memoir, he describes this occasion vividly. He says, I quote, "He spent weeks mugging up engineering formulae, details of cement and brick manufacture, and the weights and composition of materials," end quote. On the actual day, he was asked what sports he played at school, how he spent his leisure hours, whether he danced and rode. He was asked next to nothing of the material he'd studied. "And so much," he wrote, "for all my weeks of cramming." Geoffrey Hall's social and sporting accomplishments and his institutional pedigree clearly carried as much weight with the committee as his technical qualifications. Once they took up their posting in India, engineers took on the role of sahibs who lorded it over their circles and divisions, even acting as magistrates. There are wonderful descriptions of railway engineers making stately inspection visits on the open lines. It's almost like a picnic sometimes, the way they write about it. There was much writing about the countryside on horseback, shikar, hunting expeditions, a lifestyle centered around bungalows, and a dozen different kinds of servant. This is a page from the diary or the memoir of the wife of a railway engineer in the Madras presidency. And this is only a partial list. There's another page of all the servants that they had in their household. right? And you can see that there's somebody doing the marketing, somebody doing the cooking. And there's even what is called a thanni kach, which is thanni kach in Tamil means to boil the water for the person to take a bath. All right. So the life could be tough at times, but it was prestigious. But these are all British engineers. What was it like being an Indian engineer? The Indians who made it to the engineering services were also molded along similar lines. Their job came with great prestige, precisely because of their status as government administrators. The perks included a stable job, government housing, a retinue of servants and subordinates, and government honors for long-serving officers. In fact, we might argue that this is one of the main reasons why engineering at that time carried great prestige, aside, of course, from the inherent interest in making things. K.L. Rao, a famous hydraulic engineer who later became a minister in independent India, records in his memoirs that he trained as an engineer in the pre-independence period on the advice of his brother, who used to look at the lifestyle of irrigation officers and the impressive boats in which they traveled in the Masulipatnam canal not far from Rao's village. However, very few Indian engineers achieved high rank in the years before World War I, although theoretically all ranks were open to them through promotion. Even the legendary figure of Sir Gangaram, who is known as the father of modern Lahore on the top of the slide, he retired from government service as an executive engineer. That's two ranks below the top rank. Sir M. Vishveshwaraya, whose birthday we are celebrating or marking today, and who's the patron saint of Indian engineers in some ways, took early retirement from the Bombay PWD, anticipating that he would not be made chief engineer at the time that he deserved. Indian engineers at this time were conscious of being judged all the time. British expatriate engineers often had a critical attitude towards their Indian colleagues. It's worth noting that they normally criticized the Indians not on the basis of their technical ability. Instead, they argued that they did not possess the integrity, the courage, the resourcefulness, etc. of their European colleagues. And you can see here a short description of how this felt for one particular engineer called Ram Das, whose son Prakash Tandon later became the first Indian chairman of Unilever, and describes this atmosphere in his wonderful book called Punjabi Century. Now, naturally, the state of affairs was a tense one, and there was bound to be some conflict within the profession. For various historical reasons, the process of change began to quicken in the years between World War I and World War II. Nationalist politicians set up a steady demand for more technical education for Indians. As they began to win a greater share of power in the legislative process, the process of Indianization, that is, replacement of British engineers in government service by suitably qualified Indians, became a very important political demand. There were many factors involved in this, including the fact that Indians were paid less, and political factors, because Indianization was, in a way, one of the concessions which the British promised to give in return for Indian support in the world wars. But as you can imagine, this Indianization was a fraught process. It was not easy, it was not uncontested. And it gave rise to all kinds of anxieties. You can have a look at this cartoon, which is the title page of a collection of cartoons which appeared in the magazine of the Great Indian Peninsula Railway, headquartered in Bombay. And it's by an artist who calls himself Joe Hookum. And is there anyone who can try and decipher what the title is referring to? The Kuch Parwane Por Swadeshi Railways. Exactly, it's Kuch Parwane Hi. So the idea is that if Indians take over the railways, anything goes. They'll do anything. They'll pull the railways by elephants, and they'll have electrical shocks because they won't know how to take care of the wiring, and so on. It's a full book of such cartoons. On a more serious note, in the interwar period between World War I and World War II, one of the problems that the British were having is that it was very difficult to attract enough British engineers to come out and serve in India. And this is not only engineers, this is true of civil servants and other services as well. And this is despite the prestige that they used to enjoy. And that's because they were worried that the political situation was changing. They didn't know how long their careers would last. And some of them were very clear. They even went so far as to say that they don't want to serve under an Indian superior or an Indian minister. After 1919, there were Indian ministers for certain subjects in the provinces. and this was anathema to some. Perhaps equally important, though, in changing the landscape was the following, that is, circumstances during World War I opened the colonial government's eyes to the need for developing India's industrial capabilities. And in the years between the two world wars, the government relaxed its laissez-faire stance and began to introduce some pro-industrial policies. This is the report of the Indian Industrial Commission, 1916 to 18, and it was a landmark commission in many ways, a landmark report, although many of its recommendations were not eventually acted upon due to many changes. It represents a change in policy thinking. And the chief change that occurred in the 1920s and 30s was the acceptance of the need for protective tariffs for selected Indian industries like steel, paper, jute, and sugar. And this enabled these industries to strike out and to compete with foreign imports. Membership statistics of professional societies indicate a corresponding rise in the number of industrially employed engineers in this period. So I looked at the lists of members in the Indian Institution of Civil Engineers, Institution of Mechanical Engineers, Institution of Electrical Engineers. They had these topographical lists which would give members names and then their addresses and so on. And I calculated that at the start of the period around 1900, most of the India resident members were civil engineers, but or rather the civil engineering, the Institution of Civil Engineers had the most members. But then as you look at the other two institutions, as industries start to find their feet, those numbers start rising. But you also see that the Indian names are rising as time goes by. So these two processes that I harp on are Indianization and industrialization, and they define the period in many ways. So in 1900, this profession had been dominated by government employees, and by the 1940s, a substantial proportion of engineers were working in private industry, and as I said, it was considerably Indianized. Now, many of the enterprises in this growing industrial sector were owned by Indian business families. A close study of these industries' modus operandi in garnering technical know-how and recruiting technical experts complicates the picture we've had so far of engineering in India. It was, of course, not all dams, bridges, and railways. It was not entirely a story of the imperial metropolis in London and the dependent colony. The Tatas, company which is well known to the Godrejes, started their iron and steel factory in Jamshedpur in the first decade of the 20th century, engaging the services of an American consulting engineer, C.P. Perrin, to design their factory. They employed a series of Americans as general managers right through to the 1930s. Technical personnel were recruited from Britain, from Germany, from the steel mills of Gary, Indiana, and of course from India itself. But where would they hire the Indians? Because at this point, as we saw, the colonial engineering education system was geared towards producing civil engineers for the PWD. So they looked for Indians who had gone abroad and returned. Indians who had gone to the US, to Germany, to study industrial subjects. And eventually the Tatas set up their own technical institute, the Jamshedpur Technical Institute, in the 1920s, where Indian graduates were put through an intense practical course of training before being recruited to the steel factory. Some of these graduates came from institutions like VJTI here, the Bengal Technical Institute in Jadavpur, and the Engineering College of the Banaras Hindu University. Note that all of these institutions in some way or the other had been built with private initiative, that is, not through the colonial government, with this partial exception of VJTI. Now, already the massive popularity of this avenue of employment was in evidence as applications to the Tata's institute poured in from all over the country. This is just a quick glimpse of C.P. Perrin, the consulting engineer who helped build the plant. To his on the right is John Keenan, who was one of the general managers of the steelworks. And this is P.N. Mathur, a very interesting Indian engineer who jumped on a ship, worked his way to America, studied at the, learned engineering at the Ford factory, came back. And there's some wonderful correspondence about the kinds of things that these people are saying when they're trying to come back and work in Indian industries. I dearly wish that when I was writing this book, I had known about the Godrej Archives, because I think that there must be a very, very interesting parallel story about how Godrej went about hiring their technical personnel. But I will say that I noticed in the little exhibition a little similarity with what I had seen. In the Tata's case, those who applied for admission to this institute, they would write all kinds of things, what their qualifications were. And there's a pencil mark in blue surrounding those entries where they're talking about their sporting accomplishments. The sporting accomplishments were taken very seriously. And there's this display of an employee of Godrej called HK Engineer in your permanent exhibition. And I saw that in the application that he writes, I think directly to Pirocha Godrej, he says, in the second paragraph, I'm a keen sportsman and I play so-and-so sports and so on. So just to say that that aspect of engineering seems to have been prized across companies and across sectors. Now, the culture of engineering in these kinds of industries, of course, was very different from the gentlemanly ideal that I've described for the PWD a little while ago. In these places, physical fitness, a willingness to work long hours on the shop floor, and a complete lack of pretentiousness were the prized attributes. T.W. Tutwiler, who was the American head of the works in TISCO, apparently told the viceroy who was visiting, when he asked him, "Are you Mr. Tutwiler?" he said, "You're goddamn right," and nearly precipitated a diplomatic crisis. This is a completely different kind of scenario to where the government engineers were working. And John Keenan recounted with approval the story of an Indian technical expert who was insulted by a Yorkshireman in the steelworks, and he just punched him, he knocked him out. So what was the common ground then between the stately government engineer and the dynamic industrial engineer? For various reasons, they did view themselves as part of a common profession. Let's look briefly at professional institutions. Until World War I, engineers working in India, both Britons and Indians, aimed to join one or more of the three prestigious professional societies that I mentioned a while ago, the Institution of Civil, Mechanical, and Electrical Engineers. This is the Institution of Civil Engineers in London. These institutions had governmental sanction, codes of conduct, and minimum qualifications in terms of education and experience for membership. They discussed technical papers, published the proceedings in journals. Increasingly, engineers in India began to feel cut off from these societies, and so they formed a new one. Of course, there were many developments before this, but ultimately they formed a new one called the Institution of Engineers India, headquartered in Calcutta in 1920, and I'm sure a lot of you are familiar with this, or may even be members or fellows of this institution. Now here, public works engineers, railway engineers, and industrial engineers met regularly and discussed their work. This was an interesting scenario because, unlike the London institutions, they were not segregated by branch. The new professional institution helped engineers in India forge a common identity. They evolved a common language of economic nationalism. They're talking about Swadeshi and the role of engineers in promoting the country's development. Unlike its cousin institutions in London, I said it wasn't subdivided by branch. Mechanical and electrical engineers mingled with civil engineers, just as British engineers mingled with Indian engineers. It was perhaps here that for the first time the notion of an Indian identity of the engineering profession was developed. By Indian identity, I mean somebody who's thinking of their identity as an engineer based in India, whether they are British or Indian themselves, and not as an offshoot of the empire's engineering profession. In the years following independence, most of the remaining British engineers were replaced by Indians, as we know. As the historian Daniel Klingensmith has ably shown, the Indians who came to prominence at this time in the 50s and 60s, like A.N. Khosla and Kamar Sen, saw themselves as building not just dams, but also building the nation. And this went well with the Nehruvian emphasis on a modern nation with a scientific temper. Another historian, Ross Bassett, in his admirable book, The Technological Indian, traces the emerging links between India and the United States in the field of technological education. And he shows that this is not a story that begins with Indian master's students in the 1960s. Bassett shows that from as early as the 1880s, Indians sponsored by business families or princely rulers had begun to gravitate towards institutes like the Massachusetts Institute of Technology. Shantanu Kirloskar is a case in point. He was sent to MIT, and several other examples in that book, including the people who helped start TCS and so on, so across generations. This trend did intensify in post-independence period. The IITs played a key part in this, of course. Often mentored by foreign, especially American institutions, the IITs produced a kind of engineer or technologist whose points of reference were global rather than specifically Indian. Many went on to make their lives and careers in the US, contributing to that country's technological landscape. A significant proportion, however, did return and were influential in setting up new kinds of industry in India. And the most visible, of course, is the software and information technology industry. So as I mentioned earlier, I'm not going to talk too much about the IIT story and the post-independence era because it's a topic that that we all are much more familiar with and because my research was focused on the earlier era. But I will say that there's plenty of room for further research on these topics. There are some very interesting books that have been coming out on the IITs, on IT as a profession, and some of the questions and even the history of computer science and the history of information technology in India. But here are some other questions that I think we can look at. How did the culture of engineering change with the coming of the IITs? We've looked at this idea of the gentlemanly engineer. We've looked at the idea of the very practical, shop floor oriented industrial engineer. But it seems to me that it's possible that the IITs throw up someone who's kind of in between these two worlds or these two cultures. That requires more research. What is it exactly that led to the boom in private engineering colleges in the 80s and 90s? Should engineering be a regulated profession? If you're a doctor, you have to be registered on the All India Medical Register. To the best of my knowledge, and please correct me if I'm wrong, you don't have to do that if you're an engineer, though you can become a chartered engineer if you'd like to have an additional qualification. In the pre-independence period, the profession was almost entirely male, as you saw from these examples. But that's changed dramatically in the last several decades. A key area of future research, therefore, is the role and experience of women in the engineering profession. Historians have also begun to investigate the social composition of the profession and key institutions. For example, what socioeconomic strata do most engineers come from? What role does caste play in the availability of engineering seats and education and careers for people and so on? So I yearn to go off at several tangents, but time is limited. So permit me to just raise a few points of discussions before I conclude. Our whistle-stop tour of the history of engineering has raised several themes. So to begin with, it helps us to add several layers to the picture of Indian history that we have for the years between 1920 and 1950. My impression of Indian history from my school textbooks was that all that happened between 1900 and 1950 was the freedom movement. Now, of course, that was very, very important, and that was perhaps the most important thing at that period. But there was a bustling world of industry and technical training and professions and jobs and other things that was chugging along in the background in those very years. And that story is not distinct from the story of political change. They are both interlinked, as we've seen in several examples. For another, World War I emerges as a hugely important milestone, perhaps as important as 1947. We are given to imagine that before 1947 is one block and after 1947 is a completely different block. But in many ways, for the historian, World War I is the real changing point when you see many of the trends changing in dramatic ways like we've seen. Several of the major Nehruvian science and technology projects had their roots in this interwar period. And the interest in engineering as a profession, including its professed role in building the country, was already in evidence from the 1920s. Careful historical study also tells us that we should be cautious about assigning cultural reasons for any society's proficiency or interest in a particular field. The Indian attitude to engineering is by no means entirely unique. Think of the Iranian engineers who fill the universities of America and who are known to many students of electrical engineering for their textbooks. Likewise with the Israelis for those who study computer science. I don't think that Indians or any other nationality possess a special or inherent ability or interest in engineering. such genetically determinist ideas would actually be potentially dangerous because they encourage us to think of people as not being able to do certain things. What I do think is that the particular form that the profession has taken in India has much to do with the way our society works and with the particular historical contingencies that we have experienced. I end with a question. I know I'm saying I will conclude, I will end, but I really am ending in a few minutes. I will end with a question, who exactly or what exactly is an engineer? And that was a question that came up at the start of the nice movie that you saw at the start of this this evening. So who exactly or what exactly is an engineer? The work of the engineer of today is vastly different from that of his or her counterpart 60 years ago. The railway engineer and the dam builder are but distant cousins of the desk-bound software engineer. There is, however, an intellectual movement that unites all of them, and that is the rise of technocracy. Technocracy is, simply put, the idea that scientific and technical experts are best placed to govern a country. Technocracy favors seemingly apolitical solutions to societal problems. Perhaps the first major technocratic thinker in India is also the individual often described as the father of Indian engineering, Sir Mokshagundam Visvesvaraya. Born in 1860, Visvesvaraya lived for nearly 102 years, during which he won fame as an irrigation engineer, as an administrator when he became Diwan of Mysore, as a developmental economist, and as an early proponent of economic planning in India. He was a fascinating figure for many reasons, an indefatigable worker and a figure of great moral rectitude. But perhaps his most lasting legacy was as follows. In combining the engineer and the technocrat in one person, he laid the foundation for the continuing aura of engineering as a career in India and the continuing appeal of technocracy. But much has changed since Visvesvaraya's age. We would do well to remember that technocracy comes packaged with certain risks. The risk of authoritarianism, the risk of bland homogeneity, the risk of an anthropocentric hubris that puts humans at the center of the world that might endanger the environment. 100 years ago, engineering was seen as a civilizing influence, applying cutting-edge scientific solutions to society's needs. Today, scholars and educators are increasingly aware that science itself is part of society and that engineering is not an external apolitical tool. In fact, good engineering requires an understanding of humans and societies too. Perhaps then the major task for today's Indian engineer will be to balance the fruits of technocratic thinking with the 21st century awareness of its limits. If she succeeds in this task, the future is bright. Thank you.